Okay, well, we're recording. So let's figure out, I gotta do a screen share. Okay, this thing just be easy. Where's Franz when you need him? Maybe. Oh, here it is. Share screens. Okay. Can everyone see this? Anybody, can you hear me?
Hello? I can hear you.
Okay, great. All right, so this is the free energy workshop. Okay. Free energy special interest group, pardon me. Of course, I'm James Rink, and I'm filling in for Crystal, who normally does the introduction. So this is our 29th meeting. And obviously, Crystal is out of town. So, and Fraz is going to help join in with us eventually. So, so a little bit about FESIG. Basically, our primary objective is built around free energy devices and, of course, developments in plasma technology, and I'm sure there's other modalities as well, which William is going to be going into today. Secondary objective is build skills. So I get to create jobs, but we're working on that one. We're getting there. And to create peace on Earth, which we can do through abundance of free energy. Okay. All right. So let's move on here. So we basically go through this every week, but essentially if we could bring together different speakers and futurists, we can maybe bring a like of minds together so we can troubleshoot this, because definitely there is free energy out there. The key is how are we going to make it happen? Because there's a lot of people out there that can't really replicate it, apparently, which I'm sure William's going to talk a little bit about that, how you can conduct a test and you have free energy, and then you conduct a test the second time, it doesn't happen. And apparently the ether has a consciousness to it. So we can certainly talk about that. But I think there is a way we can do this in a way that's easily replicable. Okay, so I guess as far it looks like new members, of course, William is William, is this the first time you've been here with joining
yes.
us? Okay, wonderful. So William is the Dr. Whodini, CEO and president of Auroratek. Oh, hopefully I said that right. Auroratek, probably.
Auroratek.
And INTALEK, Inc. Free energy, anti-gravitational, time travel devices and systems. Time travel device. Well, you can definitely have to talk about that. That sounds fascinating. And, of course, the others as well. And he wrote papers on the key to harnessing free energy from the vacuum in Newtonian torsion physics. Of course, torsion is spinning motion. So be curious to see what you have to say about that. And Franz, Tom. Okay, so these are all some of the other people that usually join us, but definitely Franz is here. I think we have Stefan is not with us right now, but he might be joining us later. Okay. So report from last meeting. I don't have that. Franz, do you want to jump in? What, number three?
Okay. Are we, is this working, this headset
yes.
now?
Yes. You sound crystal clear. Great.
Excellent. Okay. Basically, last week, we did a recap of what our team, the Plasma Frontier Group, has been working with, along with Mike Nash and his Infinity Project, where we basically did a quick rundown of car unit and the introduction to the generators and lift systems. So it's going to be quite interesting having William here with us today.
Great. Wonderful. Okay, so I went ahead and did an introduction, the PowerPoint. And then, so we can go ahead to the next on the agenda, which I guess I read the full bio here. Auroratek.com is the only other thing I wanted to mention. That's William's website. So why don't you just go ahead and share a little bit more about yourself, William? And we can go from there.
Okay. Well, I graduated from Illinois Institute of Technology with a degree in electrical engineering. And I just want to mention that never once have I ever heard the name Nikola Tesla mentioned in any of my courses. So IIT, that is an Ivy League school, you can get full engineering degrees there. Mainly bachelor's, science, master's degree.
You have to go back to 1955. That's when they started removing Tesla from all those school textbooks. I'm not trying to date you, give away your age. Yeah, that's a role, which I believe there is a conspiracy behind that. But yeah, it makes a lot of sense. But please continue.
Okay, so since that time, I pursued a career doing hardware, software work, applying what I learned in college to various jobs. Did a lot of consulting work for a lot of the aerospace companies, trucking companies like Cummins Diesel, Mack Trucks, worked on diesel engine controls, worked at Motorola in their automotive divisions. So I did a lot of hardware, software type work. And then back in 1997, I started listening to this Art Bell show, kind of caught my interest. And his fellow by the name of Richard Hoagland, of course, talked about his Monuments of Mars book, Artifacts on Mars, and that sort of thing. And he teamed up with this researcher by the name of Tom Bearden. And what's interesting about Tom Bearden is that he extensively studied what was called the Floyd Sweet device. And that seemed to be the main focus of Tom's work. And so 1997, Richard Hoagland and Tom Bearden put on a conference in Seattle. And mainly the subject of it was free energy and anti-gravity. And that kind of caught my interest. And I decided to attend that conference. And I was completely blown away by the information that Tom Bearden presented. So it was very fascinating. He wrote a number of papers. And that's when I started putting together a library of information. And I collected a lot of this information and posted it on my website. And it's all still there, going way back. A lot of this information was presented, I think, in the 1960s and 70s. A number of researchers in the 70s, you know, they started putting on these conferences and presenting a lot of information. Now, back in the late 90s, what really took off, you know, in the research field, is that a lot of experimentalists started to get together on these Yahoo e-groups. And it became very popular. And so one of the popular sites, Jean-Louis Naudin, is JLNL Labs. I even had my own research group. And a lot of these people were putting together information, collecting a lot of this information, and posting it, you know, in these e-groups. And so I collected the information, put it on my website, and put together a library. And the listener out there can go to intalek.com, spelled I-N-T-A-L-E-K.com. You can check out the library of information. And of course, Tom Bearden really spearheaded, you know, a lot of this research in this area. He wrote a number of papers. The only thing about Tom's work is that when he really wanted to experiment with some of his work, there was really nothing to experiment with, is what I discovered. He presented a lot of information. He, of course, is a nuclear engineer, retired, and was doing a lot of these lecture circuits, you know, at these various conferences. But his main focus was, of course, on this Floyd Sweet device, which to me is probably the most amazing device I ever heard of. And I've been researching the device now since really he talked about it back in 1997. And I've given a number of lectures at the Extraordinary Technology Conference that's held every year in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Steve Ellswick runs that conference. So I've been presenting lately, about the past 4 years, 3 or 4 years now, information that I've been collecting and researching and building devices and doing all these testing. And the conclusion that I'm coming to is, okay, the Floyd Sweet device, and there were a number of eyewitnesses of this device said, yeah, this thing really worked. I mean, it was a genuine free energy device where you put a milliwatt in and you get kilowatts out. And of course, that's a big mystery, you know, how he actually did this. But when you start looking at the theory that's been presented over the years, and the best theory that I ran across was this article that was published in Infinite Energy magazine back in 2002. And it's called The Dirac Equation and the Sea of Negative Energy. Of course, Tom talks about this too. This fellow by the name of D.L. Hodgson, he wanted to become a physicist, but of course he asked all the wrong questions with his professors. And they basically took him aside and said, no, you're not going to become a physicist because you're too radical, you're too rogue. And so anyway, the guy is absolutely brilliant, this Hodgson, brilliant. And he wrote this equation. It's on my website. You can download it. And it's called the Dirac Equation and the Sea of Negative Energy. And what this basically talks about is really the background you need to understand what's going on with the Floyd Sweet device. And what he's, and when you look at all the information presented by Floyd, you look at some of his papers, and really, I mean, Floyd was a brilliant experimentalist himself, and I don't think he really was able to understand even what he was doing, even though he had this amazing device. But when you put it into the context of this Dirac equation, and when you look at the background of the Dirac equation, which was published back in 1928, it all starts to fall together. Okay, and you can actually explain the phenomena that's going on in the Floyd Sweet device just with this Dirac equation. Now, the solution, when you go and look this up on the internet with the Dirac equation, it was published by Dr. Paul Dirac back in 1928. And the physicists back then, you know, all the big names, you know, in the physics community, like Oppenheimer, Heisenberg, Einstein, they all looked at this equation and they had a real problem with it. And that, of course, was the negative energy solution that actually came out of the Dirac equation. There's negative energy, there's a negative energy component. And the solution of the Dirac equation is E equals plus or minus mc squared. That's the solution. So you not only have positive mass, positive energy, you also have negative mass, negative energy. And of course, Hodson wrote about this, saying that, wait a minute here, this positive and negative energy is symmetrical about the zero point axis. And what that represents, zero point, is like a boundary between universes. And of course, when you study some of the Hindu philosophy, you find out, and this was actually presented in a movie just a few months ago called Doctor Strange. And what Doctor Strange, what they put in that movie was, of course, the real, they had the real universe, but all these alternative energy, all these alternative universes. And one, of course, was what was called a mirrored universe. And that's what you find out here with the Dirac equation, is that when you look at the solution, positive and negative energy, the negative energy is this mirrored universe. And of course, a subject of research in universities is what's called phase conjugation, a phase conjugated mirror, which is a reflection I believe they're using either radio, light waves produce a phase conjugated reflection. And of course, Tom Bearden talks about that too. Okay, so with the Dirac solution, which was in 1928, it was actually taken out, the negative energy solution. They took that out of Dirac's equation by using a mathematical trick. And so you're just left with a positive energy solution and a zero point, and that's it. That's all you got. So what I did in a lot of my research here is take the negative energy solution and just put it back in and start working with that. And what you find out is that you have a symmetrical mirrored universe, all right? That's both positive and negative energy, and it's symmetrical about the zero-point axis. Now, zero-point represents a boundary between dimensions. In other words, you can't get below zero-point. It's kind of like the boundary of the universe is a zero-point. But then what about this negative energy solution? Where is that? Well, it shows up in what's called complex equations. Okay, complex math reveals negative energy. So that when I start doing the calculations and I find out that, hey, you know, I have a complex equation here, I find out that you're actually working with a negative mass, negative energy. And that, of course, what the Floyd Sweet device was doing, is that he was tapping into this other Dirac universe of negative energy, the sea of negative energy. And so a lot of that background is, of course, this is on my website at Auroratek. There's this brilliant publication here by Hodson. And so, you know, what are the characteristics of this sea of negative energy? And I did a presentation last year identifying all the components. Of course, everyone's familiar with the real universe. I mean, that's what we're stuck with in mainstream science. I mean, you don't dare go into the negative energy solution because according to mainstream science, it isn't there. There's nothing there. Okay, so naturally, you're not gonna be able to do any free energy devices. You can't do anti-gravity or any sort of warp drive technology unless you factor in this negative energy solution, okay, into what you're doing. And again, I want to mention that, you know, Tom Bearden touched on this in a lot of his research. And so the negative energy, well, what's, now, real space, real 3D space is what we're all familiar with. You only have positive energy, positive mass. Time is only time forward, okay? you have positive temperature, and what's generally referred to as the negative space-time curvature. This is, of course, what general relativity gives you. You know, you only have negative space-time curvatures, you know, created by the presence of a mass. And that's what gives you a negative space-time curvature. You find that, of course, in general relativity. Gravity is always attractive, okay, in real 3D space. Now, what are the characteristics of this complex space? Okay, the mirrored universe, you know, the sea of negative energy, you know, that Hodson was talking about. Well, first of all, this mirrored universe is at right angles to our universe, to the real 3D space. It's at right angles, which means that it's, you can only represent it as a complex number. And you see those complex solutions in the Dirac equation. You have negative energy and negative mass. Time is reversed. Time flows backwards, okay, in this complex universe. You have negative temperatures, okay? Space-time curvature is positive rather than negative in our real 3D space. You have positive space-time curvature. And of course, gravity is repulsive in this mirrored universe. Okay, so those are the characteristics of this complex 3D space that is at right angles to our real 3D space. Okay, so what Floyd Sweet did, and I talked about this in my lectures last year and the year before last, is that his device is tapping into this the sea of negative energy, this complex space. And so how is he doing it? Well, what he does, and he actually mentioned this in an email. This email is available on my website, where Floyd is communicating some information to a researcher by the name of Watson, who was behind the this one Yahoo e-group investigating the Floyd Sweet device, the VTA, which was a term coined by Tom Bearden. And so what Floyd did is that he talks about, he used these magnets, he used a set of coils between these magnets, and he talked about conditioning these magnets. And so what did he do? What was the conditioning process? Well, what Floyd did is that he took these magnets and he essentially reprogrammed the magnetization of those magnets such that the poles of the magnetization of the ferrite material, bearing ferrite material that he was using, had opposing directions where you have north-north, south-south, north-north, south-south configuration in magnetic material. Now that puts a lot of stress on that material. And of course, Floyd said sometimes when he would overpower his system, the magnets would literally blow up in his kitchen laboratory. That's because there's just so much stress, all right, when you reprogram those magnets, because you're dealing with repulsive forces in this magnetic configuration here. Very powerful opposing forces. And so this opposing force action is a key ingredient for tapping into negative energy. Yet they have this opposing field configuration. So what's going on at the quantum level? All right, what's going on here? Well, you essentially have what's going on in a superconductor, where you set up your electrons in a Cooper pair that are in an opposing configuration. Your material's close to absolute zero, so there's very little energy there. And so what you have are these electrons in this opposing configuration. And what I discovered was that there's, and you can look this up on the internet, it's a, there's a lot of information on my website. There's counter rotation going on, okay, with these electrons. So they're rotating in opposite directions. So what that gives you is a nullification of mass. And then when you set up this opposing configuration, which is produced by the lattice structure, the lattice atomic structure of the material, forces these electrons in this opposing configuration, there you are tapping into the negative energy realm, okay, when you set up this opposing configuration. And that's what Floyd Sweet had in his reprogrammed magnets, was of course this opposing action. This is what gives you access to the negative energy realm, all right? Because in order for those electrons to hang together like that, okay, in this opposing configuration, above absolute zero, there has to be some sort of a negative energy component, okay, keeping those macro particles together like that. There's negative energy involved in that. And you're basically not going to find that anywhere, you know, in any textbook that it kind of manifests, you know, how to tap into this negative energy realm, which brings up a good point in this Dirac equation, okay, that Hodson published. And that is what you know about the standard model in physics is entirely wrong, okay? The standard model is totally wrong. It's been misinterpreted.
Yeah, you know, hold on a second. Hold on. William, hold on a second. Shanman, could you please mute your mic? And thank you for joining us. Thank you. All right, continue, William. Sorry to interrupt you.
Okay. Yeah, what Hodson talks about is that, you know, the standard model, there's huge problems with the standard model. Because for one thing, it doesn't explain negative energy. The other problem is how atoms are constructed, all right, that you have these electrons and protons and neutrons. And Hodson does get into that, that a neutron is really a collection of electrons. According to Hodson, there's really only one fundamental particle in the universe. And that, of course, is this electron. And then from the electron, you get the positron, which was later discovered by, you know, after Dirac published his equation, you have the electron, the positron. And one set has positive mass and the other one has negative mass. So you can have a negative mass electron and negative mass positron. The only trouble is that these other fundamental particles are in this other mirrored universe, all right? Okay, so the standard model has some real issues to it because it was how it was interpreted. And of course, you know, the brilliant minds back then in the 1920s and 30s took out this negative energy solution. So we're left with a crippled physics. And of course, Michio Kaku always talks about how we want a unified theory. You're never, ever going to get to a unified theory when your only understanding of the universe is just positive energy and zero point. You're never going to get there. You can only get there if you understood the Dirac equation, because the Dirac equation is the theory of everything, okay, according to Hodson. It is the theory of everything. It's right there. And we had this solution back in the 1920s, and of course the experts all took out the negative energy solution. So that's what's really behind the Floyd Sweet device. Because we're dealing with a technology that is tapping into this negative energy solution of the Dirac equation. Okay, so I've been talking about this in a number of lectures, and I presented these slides for example, the direct solution. The direct solution was first introduced by Oliver Heaviside back in 1890, but without the negative sign. So you had E equals MC squared. Of course, Einstein picked up on that. The direct equation, energy can be positive or negative. Already talked about that. Mass can be positive or negative. And 0 point is the boundary between positive and negative energy. And of course, at 0 point is where efficiencies go to infinity. All right. When I did the calculations, I discovered that your efficiencies at 0 point are essentially infinite. Okay. And so you have these quantum tunneling effects. Of course, with the superconductor, the Cooper pairs, there's no mass with the Cooper pair. The mass essentially goes to zero. And of course, the quantum tunneling effect is that you have zero resistance with a Cooper pair. And of course, you find out that a Cooper pair is above 0 point. You know, they're striving to get these Cooper pairs to operate at room temperature. And that, of course, is your Cooper pair with a large amount of negative energy. Okay, if you're going to be way above 0 point, there has to be a lot of negative energy present, okay, with that Cooper pair. And that's what the Floyd Sweet device, you know, when you set up these opposing field action, okay, and as magnets, they're essentially macro Cooper pairs, okay, that he's operating at room temperature, because you're getting this opposing field action going and allows you to tap into this negative energy realm. So this is pretty much what I discovered with the Floyd Sweet device. Now, I also did a lot of experimentation with this. And found out, yes, you can tap into this negative energy realm. And I do demos for people showing a transformer that works like just the opposite of a regular transformer. So in other words, I take a core, the core has opposing field action in it, and I can insert that into a coil and compare readings that I see on the meters with a standard transformer that uses an iron core. And I observe that when I insert this opposing core action to my coils, I discover that, yes, the input, because we're tapping into this negative energy realm, it's forcing the electrons that are flowing in that circuit. Okay, the field energy, you're actually decreasing the field energy produced by the electron flow through the wires. You're forcing that energy to decrease, and that's what Floyd Sweet device did. On the input side virtually vanished. Now, when you do the math on the Floyd Sweet device, wait a minute. You know, you're putting a kilowatt in, you get a kilowatt out. That's still correct. You know, that mindset is still correct. But that's if you're operating in the positive energy realm. All right. When you're operating in the negative energy realm, that input field is going to vanish. It's going to decrease. And that's why he was seeing a milliwatt coming in. Okay. Because he was forcing those electrons to curl right into direct hyperspace, this direct sea of negative energy. The electron fields would curl right into hyperspace. So you had this negative energy work function, okay, is what you have. The real field vanishes, it decreases. That's why you only see a residual amount of a milliwatt, because there's still some real power there, a milliwatt coming in. But you have this kilowatt of negative energy, this negative energy work function, all right, that's tapping into the sea of negative energy. And then the output, you just drive regular loads with your output. which is what you'll see in the descriptions of transformers on the internet. The input, you're driving a coil. That coil has a negative energy work function applied to it, forcing the real field to vanish. The output is driving a real load, which is external to the device. And that, of course, has a positive work function. So you see a kilowatt out, a milliwatt coming in. So that's pretty much how the Floyd Sweet device worked. So the whole trick of this thing is, of course, replicating that technology, but doing it on a commercial scale. I mean, Floyd Sweet said that the effect would only last maybe a couple of weeks before the magnets would start to lose their magnetization, and then you lose your negative work function, okay, and it falls back into positive energy. And so I'm working on a solution here that will keep that stable for almost indefinitely, okay? So working on a solution of this Floyd Sweet device that would apply a negative work function on your input, okay, and the output can drive a real load, okay, a kilowatt out. So you have a milliwatt coming in, or maybe a few watts coming in and a kilowatt coming out. Depends upon what your negative work function is, okay, that you apply with this opposing field action, which allows you to tap into this negative energy. So that's the whole theory and operation behind the Floyd Sweet device. And then a number of years ago, I made a very interesting discovery about the electron. And in mainstream science, you know, in your textbooks, they always consider the electron to be a point particle. But when I did a lot of my work here, considering the positive and negative energy side of things, I discovered that the electron really isn't a point particle. It can be described as a sphere with literally nothing inside the electron. It's completely empty. In other words, it's just a spinning vortex of something. And so the electron has a radius and it has a surface area. And that's all that describes an electron. And of course, what Hodson gets into is something called angular momentum, that these are very high speed rotating spheres, are these electrons. And then from that electron, you can build an entire universe with it, with just one particle, okay? But the real mystery there is, of course, charge. You know, electron has a negative charge, positron has this positive charge to it. You have this duality going on. And I come to the conclusion that this duality has to do with time reversal, with the flow of time. That in our real universe, we describe what we have, a positive flow of time. In the Dirac sea of negative energy, in its complex space, time is reversed. And this kind of correlates with what Feynman talked about back in the 1950s. And I talk about that on my website. The Feynman-Stuckelberg theory or something, presented this back in the 1950s, I believe, that the positron was a time-reversed particle. And when I look at it in the context of my research, I found out, well, he's partially right. Feynman is partially right. The charge is time reversed, all right? Because again, we're working with this sea of negative energy. And so the electron is time for the charge. I'm talking about the charge, the state of the electron, the state of the electron. There's various properties of electron. You have, of course, the spin property, the state of the electron, and the phase. And in our technology, what we're developing is that you control the phase of the electron. That's opposing action here. Okay, but when we get back to the state of the electron, it can be either positive or negative, and it has to do with time reversal. So the charge of the electron can either be time forward, which is your electron. The positron charge can be negative, okay, in complex space. So we see a time forward electron, a time reversed positron, but wait a minute, that positron can manifest in the real 3D universe. You can't have, you cannot have a time reversed particle in real 3D space. It can only exist in complex space. Okay, anything that's time reversed is not in our universe. Okay, so what Floyd Sweet was doing, he was forcing electrons to curl by this negative energy function, to curl into hyperspace, just by setting up the supposing field action. All right, that's the phase of the electron. I'm talking about the phase of the electron. But the state of the electron can have positive or negative charge. And this positron is a time reverse particle, but only due to its charge that's on the surface of the electron. But what about the mass of the electron? There's nothing inside the electron. It just has a radius, the electron has a radius, and a surface area. There's nothing inside of it. It's just a spinning vortex. So it has angular momentum. And that's another important property of the electron, is angular momentum. Because it turns out that, yes, there is a Lorentz ether. And so I talk about this too. Hodson gets into the electromagnetic ether, which is composed of electron-positron pairs. There is no such thing as creation or annihilation. It doesn't exist in the Dirac universe. It only exists in this thing of what they kind of cobble together called the standard model, and what they're currently practicing in physics today. Okay, you have creation, annihilation of electrons and positrons and how they're created or they're annihilated. But you see in the Dirac universe that there's no such thing as that, because all it does is when electron-positron pair forms, you just go back into the electromagnetic ether. Now, according to Hodson, his last paragraph or last couple of pages in his first article on Infinite Energy magazine, he talks about these pairs. Now, they only exist at zero point. And of course, the quantum physicists know you have this perturbation of space. And those are electron-positron pairs going between our space and Dirac hyperspace. And we're kind of doing this dance right there at zero point. Okay? All right, so these electron-positron pairs have the ability to polarize. Probably heard of vacuum polarization. And all that they're doing is just transferring angular momentum, okay, between the electron and another positron. There's actually angular momentum that's being transferred from the electron to these pairs. And as long as the energy is under a certain level, they have to propagate this energy, okay? And this energy is light. Light is not a particle. It is a wave of angular momentum traveling in the ether, okay, this electromagnetic ether, being transferred along as a big chain of electron-positron pairs, okay? And this is what you have with magnets. If you take the field of a magnet, you have these flux lines, okay? We're taught about these flux lines. Well, guess what? These flux lines really do exist, because they're just these chains of electron-positron pairs transferring at the speed of light this angular momentum, okay, as it propagates along from the electron to a receiver, which is another positron. Okay, you have this chain of angular momentum going on, and that is a photon. That's how Hodson describes a photon. This is transfer of angular momentum. Okay, so photons, you can have anti-photons, okay, with this technology. And of course, what Floyd Sweet was getting into in this other Dirac universe, all right? You can have anti-photons, negative mass, negative energy, the energy in this angular momentum, because that's all that you have with an electron. Electron is basically an empty vortex, okay, of whatever. There's some sort of a cosmic soup, okay, that is, it's a vortex of this whatever that's spinning. And of course, its moment is actually a complex number. It's not like a regular top, but its angular momentum gets transferred from this electron-positron pairs that Hodson calls EPOS, E-P-O-S. And when it does so, when it starts transferring this angular momentum, it transforms the EPOS from a boson spin zero macroparticle to a boson spin one particle, macroparticle. So that's when it acquires the angular momentum and starts forming these chains and propagating what we call light as angular momentum. Hodson calls it EPHOS, E-P-H-O-S, which are electron-positron pairs that acquire angular momentum. And depending upon what the phase is, and of course, Hodson says that Feynman didn't really clarify what phase was, but he did include it with his paper. The phase is what we're interested in as quantum vacuum engineers, engineering the vacuum is what we're doing, is that when these pairs acquire that angular momentum, they become this boson spin one EPHOS macroparticle. And that's what's around a magnet. It's basically transferring this energy of angular momentum in lines of flux. And the flux in this case are the EPOS-EPHOS, and EPHOS acquires angular momentum. And that's what's transferring the energy in this magnet. And that phase of that angular momentum is what we're interested in, you know, as this quantum vacuum engineers here. For these devices, because the phase, when we apply our negative work function with our technology, is that we're forcing the field, the angular momentum, to curl into this Dirac hyperspace. So we want to control that phase, and I actually show that in an equation. You can actually see this in action here. I'm reworking the paper that is going to talk about this, but you can actually see it's called gravitomagnetic theory, and it's in my book. I actually wrote this back in 2005. I put everything, all my knowledge, in this book. It's called Newtonian Torsion Physics. You can find it at intellect.com. It's gravitomagnetic theory. This is where I talk about electron. Gee, there's nothing in this electron. It's just a spinning vortex of whatever that has angular momentum. It has this mysterious thing called charge. And that charge can either be positive or negative charge, time forward or time reverse charge. And then, of course, this angular momentum related to the spin properties of these electrons and how they get transferred, okay, along this EPOS chain. So I talk about the electron, I talk about the phase of the electron, and that's what we're really doing here, controlling that phase of that wave that's being transferred in that chain. And if we want to tap into negative energy, we just force that phase to curl right into hyperspace. And of course, the electron that affects the electron puts a torque. Because when you set up these electrons in this opposing field action, you're actually putting a torque, forcing the moment of those electrons to curl right into hyperspace. That's what gives you this access to this negative energy realm. And when it curls, you're changing the phase of that wave or of that angular momentum. Okay. And so from a theoretical standpoint, yeah, everything here is consistent. You need not only time forward, but time reversal to make this all work. And it just comes out in the equations. I mean, everything is there. For a long time, you know, I wondered, what are these complex numbers? But then I came to the realization that, you know, gives you negative energy, negative mass, velocities can become complex. So movement, okay, working with complex numbers. You know, this is why these, this UFO phenomena, why the ship is there, and then at an instant, it vanishes from sight. The question is, where did that UFO go? I mean, it's still there. The UFO is still there, but they were able to control the phase of these electrons that make up the vehicle. They were able to control the phase of those electrons by applying this opposing forcing function, okay, to force these electrons to curl right into hyperspace, okay? So the ship is still there. You can't see it, but it curled right into hyperspace. So in a way, it's still there. And then what you do to that, because what you're doing there is manipulating mass, and I do talk about this. You know, I got a lecture coming up this year at Coffee. I'll be presenting this at Tom Vallone's Coffee. One is developing practical warp drive engine technology just based on what I've been talking about here. The other lecture is going to be inertial gravitational mass modification for faster than light deep space applications. And another thing that I discovered with this is that we're not only manipulating mass due to counter rotation, and that's what these vehicles do. There's a counter rotating component to these craft, to any circular saucer craft. There's a counter rotation going on. That's what gives you mass nullification. The other effect is where they can apply a high voltage, and that's a vacuum polarization effect. And that's warp drive. What we had warp drive technology since the 1920s with the Byfield-Brown effect. And also I'll be talking about that at Coffee. And what you have are something called an asymmetric capacitor. And an asymmetric capacitor, that's where you concentrate the flux lines, electric flux lines, at a point, like in the lifter technology, that is true anti-gravitational technology. It's not just ion flow going on there. It's not just an ion action, which is mainly dismissed by the mainstream scientists. But you concentrate the flux at a point, and then you spread out the flux on a foil, okay, if you look at the lifter design, or what Byfield-Brown effect did back in the 1920s, is that they have this antenna at the top of their saucer, and then they distribute the flux lines across a surface. And when you do that, you can affect the phase of this vacuum polarization effect that's occurring there. Again, we're affecting the phase. And and of course, to tap into, you know, for example, warp drive technology, that is where you concentrate the flux at a point, giving you negative space-time curvature. When you spread it out, like you do with the posing, counter-rotating posing fields that happen to the Barnett effect. You're actually spreading the field out. And when you do that, you're creating a positive space-time curvature, okay? Which allows you to tap into Dirac-C of negative energy. And what you end up with is something called the El-Khoubri warp drive. Now, NASA, you know, Mike Willard Khoubri came out with that back in 1995, presented it to NASA, but only on a theoretical basis. So in other words, if you took general relativity, extended it into Dirac hyperspace, now you have a full model that can not only describe negative space-time curvature, but also positive space-time curvature, okay, with the Dirac hyperspace. When you have this positive space-time curvature, gravity is repulsive, okay? In real 3D space, gravity is attractive, so that creates a fall-forward scenario, okay? When you have in front of your vehicle negative space-time curvature, behind your vehicle positive space-time curvature, and you have a little pocket, okay, between the two of neutral space, and that's what could travel at any velocity, okay? And I do mean any velocity. I mean, you're not limited to the speed of light, okay? So you have this negative in front of the craft, positive behind the craft, and create this fall forward scenario of propulsion. It's a propulsion technique. And then in terms of anti-gravity, and Floyd Sweet actually touched on this, mentioned that his device lost about 90% of its weight when it was operating at full power, you know, putting what a milliwatt in, kilowatts out. The device actually became lighter, okay? It had this anti-gravitational effect to it. Well, you know, what I'm talking about here also explains that phenomenon, that you have anti-gravity, this repulsive nature that you find in with Dirac hyperspace. Gravity is repulsive. So you have this anti-gravitational effect also associated with that. And that, of course, is this, what I'll be presenting at AeroDeath, you know, at Fort Worth, Texas here. I'll be talking about that. That's coming up here just in a few weeks. So I've got my presentation for that. And then at the coffee event, developing practical warp drive engine technology using what's called the Barnett effect. And that's where you set up, you take magnets, you start to rotate them. You have this field amplification effect that occurs. Now, of course, this was discovered back in 1908 by Barnett. When you take a piece of brass, like in a brass gyroscope, as a half spin property with the material. You spin that and it literally creates a magnetic field, okay, out of the, I believe it comes out of the axis of this material, you have this magnetic field. Well, what we're doing here with this warp drive engine technology is that we take our magnets, we spin them, okay, for this Barnett effect to take, and we amplify the field, okay, of these magnets. Behind the ship, we want to tap into Dirac-C of negative energy. So we counter-rotate these magnets, okay? So that creates a positive space-time curvature of the craft. And this is what I call a practical warp drive engine, taking the El-Khoubri model and actually implement that as a practical warp drive engine with this rotation that's going on here. So that's what we're doing with warp drive, with negative space-time curvature and positive space-time curvature, are spinning these magnets. Of course, you've probably heard of the Nazi Bell device. That's a counter-rotating system where they set up counter-rotating drums of basically copper wire. My take on the Nazi Bell device was that they had these drums of copper wire where they counter-rotated them, producing an opposing field action, gives you access to direct hyperspace. And of course, this levitation. So you have mass nullification, and then the negative energy component is where you set up this opposing field action. So that's where you tap into negative energy. And I successfully replicated the Boyd-Bushman experiment. Boyd-Bushman was a Lockheed Skunk Works weapons developer. And he proposed this concept to a fellow by the name of David Serrata. Serrata made a video of it, of Boyd-Bushman talking about his experiment, where he takes two magnets, neodymium, very powerful magnets, and forces them together. Okay, I mean, these things want to fly apart. It's like a bullet. And I ended up replicating his experiment. And the results of his experiment, and this is really interesting, is that he went to a Lockheed Skunk where he describes his experiment, where he goes to an elevator shaft and replicates the Galileo experiment, where he drops the opposing magnetic field, neodymium magnets, and just an ordinary rock, he dropped them down an elevator shaft. And every time he dropped them, the ordinary rock would hit first, and then second would be this opposing field action. Now, what's interesting about that is that if you take any mass, any object with mass, they're always going to fall at the same rate. So there's something else going on here. There's some sort of an anti-gravitational effect that is allowing the opposing field action to fall slower. And it turns out that I replicated his experiment and said, yeah, you know, Bushman was right about this. I went to this place in Sedona that had a big tower, and I dropped a rock and then the opposing field action, and found out, yeah, you know, it does fall slower. So we not only have a mass modification effect occurring here, but we also have another effect, okay, of the, we're actually changing the gravitational constant around those opposing fields. And mainstream science is starting to recognize that the gravitational constant, which is really the strength of the gravitational field, isn't a constant. It's not really a constant. So I'm finding out that, yeah, we can engineer big G in that equation. Okay, we can engineer that gravitational constant. And that's what happens when you set up this opposing field action. You're actually changing, you know, we're forcing the angular momentum of this flux, you know, to curl right into hyperspace. So that's going to affect the space around these magnets. But also, if you just use ordinary magnets in the attractive configuration, I discovered that it fell faster. All right, it fell faster than the rock. So the flux lines in real field, okay, is also interacting, okay, with the gravitational constant, forcing that rock to fall faster. And so right there, knowing that, gee, you know, I can implement the Alcubierre warp drive, not just from theory, but to practice, okay, just by using these magnets. One in opposing configuration, one in attractive configuration, creating this negative space-time curvature and then positive space-time curvature, creating a fall forward scenario. And I end up building a mobile. Okay, I built a mobile using this configuration, and I found out, yeah, it produces a very tiny torque, okay, in one direction. So there you have it, perpetual motion. That's one of the things that I've been working on here. I've been working on a bigger one using big 4-inch monsters of neodymium magnets because I want to create this perpetual motion mobile just by using this Alcubierre warp drive technique here. And let's see, what else? Well, did you know that we had anti-gravity back in the 1950s? and I'll be talking about this. There was an article published in Young Men magazine talking about Bill Lear. Okay, probably heard of John Lear. He's on the lecture circuit here. His father, Bill Lear, was, of course, the creator of the Lear jet. Bill Lear was very interested in anti-gravity work. And this article, published in Young Men magazine back in November of 1956, I got that article here. It's on my website, so if you want to read about this, it's there. It says here, the G engines are coming. Okay, 1956. Anti-gravity engines working without fuel, weightless airliners and spaceships able to travel at the speed of 170,000 miles per second. Gravity research has been supported by Lear, Inc., who would not spend millions of dollars on science fiction. William Lear is already figuring out gravity control. Now, where did he get his incredible technology from? Well, it turns out that there was a researcher that I've been in contact with by the name of Dan Davidson. He's into shape power, some gravity control, that sort of thing. He knew a researcher, an alternative energy researcher back in the 50s. Dan Davidson knew this researcher when he was a kid. Used to go to his lab. His name was Larry Wilson. And he sent me some emails about Larry Wilson, who was the brains behind Bill Lear's anti-gravity control. And so what did he do? What did Larry Wilson do in his lab? Well, he's had what I've been talking about here, counter-rotating opposing field action using magnets on a disc. He counter-rotated them, which gives you access to this direct sea of negative energy. And according to Dan Davidson, this device just floated right off when it was just running, counter-rotating at just a few thousand RPM. According to Dan, this thing just floated right off the lab floor. So again, you know, he was using counter-rotating opposing field action. You see the same phenomena occurring with the Nazi Bell device. There you, again, counter-rotating opposing field action. You know, you're essentially your Cooper pair right there at a macro scale. And I think that's about it. I think I covered just about everything. That's about super.
Okay, I'm going to ask you a question.
Yeah.
We're going into basic magnetism is the question.
Right.
When we place the film over the top of the neodymium magnets or the regular magnets, we start seeing the magnetic field in these specialized plastic shields. It's basically a ferrite material locked between two pieces of plastic.
Right.
I grab it real quick. I have a big sheet. Okay. It's fun for about 15 minutes, then it becomes boring. But it basically takes the old iron filings on the piece of paper and you put the magnet below it and it shows you your fields from the magnet streaming out in basically toroidal shapes. When we go to the cool plastic sheet, we actually see in real time these toroidal spaces fields starting to show up in three-dimensional layers as we go through with the plastic sheets, different ones. The question that I have when we take a look at it is the north and south poles that we know as magnetism have fields that are unidirectional? Or are they a bidirectional field and the spaces that we see with the iron filings and with our plastic sheets is basically the interface of the two opposing fields.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you see, what I did with experimenting with magnets is I replicated this experiment on the, there's this website, HYIG or something.org. I forget the fellow who runs that website, but he has a video on that website where he sets up a CRT screen. And of course, this is something that Floyd Sweet had. He had his CRT, and it would display the pattern of the fields produced by his magnets, okay? And I ended up replicating this this experiment done by this fellow at this website, where he took a magnet and put it near the screen of a CRT, and you would see the field would deflect the electrons approaching the screen. All right. And then what he did is that he took another magnet, and if that magnet is in the attractive configuration, you would approach the magnet that was near the screen, and you would actually see the field energy of that magnet increase. Okay, so the field energy would increase as your second magnet and the attractive configuration would approach your primary magnet there. Now, he extended his experiment there and showed what would happen when you take your magnet in the opposing configuration. So as you start to approach the magnet there, you would see a decrease in the field energy of that magnet. It would basically vanish. You know, if you force the two magnets together, the field energy would vanish, all right? Well, what's actually going on there is that what I see is that the field is actually curling. It's still there. And a lot of times this, I think, been misinterpreted as mainly a magnetic monopole type of phenomena. And of course, mathematically, you can't have monopoles. In a way, yeah, you're absolutely right about that, because what the field is doing is that the field actually becomes complex. It goes from a B field to a JB field, okay? It becomes complex and then curls right into hyperspace. So really, the field is still there, even though you can't see it in real 3D space. The field is still there, but it curled right into hyperspace. And this is where the B field becomes complex. I mean, even mathematically, I see that in my equations. And of course, when you calculate the energy in that field, okay, because the angular momentum that's being transferred from the electron is the mass of the electron. That is the mass. That angular momentum becomes complex, and so JB, you know, is a complex equation, and the field energy becomes negative at that point. So the real field vanishes. Now, I think what you're mentioning, you said something about a vortex, points of vortex forms, like little eddies.
Yes. Yeah, you end up, my first understanding of this was to look at the magnetic fields with the iron filings. The interesting part was that the fields, the iron particles, ended up end to end. They didn't end up like a bunch of trees sticking out from it. You're not looking at one field sticking from the other, per se, but you have basically these eddies where the iron filings line up. Now, when we go to these screens, we end up seeing these in actual three-dimensional toroids around the entire magnet. like giant domes, but there is gaps between them. You have expansion on the outside, you have contraction towards the inner, especially when you go to the circular magnets, where you're actually increasing this toroidal effect through them. We see the same thing happening when we talk with Tesla's stuff and he starts dealing with his circular coils where you've got a tube. And we end up with an electron flood, an electron vortices or a magnetic gravitational change similar to the magnets. And so what I started looking at was, are these in fact bands of iron filings and the bands of no iron filings, are they representative of the same phenomena? Or are they opposing phenomena or for opposing explorations? And in my understanding, these are actually opposing vortices of action. Mm-hmm. And what's in between where the magnetic lines show up is just that spot where everything lines up and everything falls into. It can be on a universe state level, very similar to where your planets line up with in their orbits around the sun in these bands.
Right. Yeah, that's the other thing that Hodson gets into. He's got a part two with his Dirac C of negative energy here. His part two gets into how the planets form these orbits. Mm-hmm. And
well, we go one more step with what you're saying, which is really quite interesting. When we take and we bend those fields and we accelerate them into a contraction, into instead of expansion side of the equation, into the contraction portion of it. If we can move one series of electrons from one's lower orbits, which we would say just because it's closer to the magnetic field, it's a lower orbit, into a higher speed orbit, which ends up going around into a larger orbit. When we, in fact, pull that into the center, we are going into this phenomenon that you're talking about of moving the electron into hyperspace.
Right.
We see a result at the other side that it accelerates through the center of the toroid. At the bottom, we see the spraying out in little vortices rather than toroids per se. When it actually gets a little more complicated on the outflow of the negative energy side of the equation. It just kind of spews out in rotating vector. What's interesting is that when we go into the whole toroid, it self-organizes, brings itself around again, and coming into a very nice formation at the top where it's coming in our 3D reality of the equation.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're looking at to harvest the zero point is to move the electrons from one band to the other and flip them into hyperspace. And then what that does is cause a draw into the whole system. So instead of using a pull system or expansion system, we are using a negative draw system for the zero point energy.
Right.
At least that's what I understand.
Well, you know, that's what I think the Casimir effect is. Because the Casimir effect, you know, is where they take two metal plates, and between those plates, there's a what they call a force. And to access this negative energy, there's something that I've been kind of kicking around here for a while. It's called a diamagnetic Casimir cavity. Diamagnetic. And diamagnetism is where you have this opposing action, okay, between these electrons. You have this opposing action going on. And that's what really taps into negative energy, because it's forcing these electrons to curl right into hyperspace. And so in order to maintain that configuration that you have in like a superconductor or in the technologies that you know, we have here, in order to maintain that, you have to apply a force, okay, to these electrons. First of all, I have to force them together. And the counter rotation is what nullifies the effect of mass, because mass is angular momentum. And Hudson talks about that. Mass is angular momentum, the rotation of these vortices that we call electrons. Mm-hmm. Okay, so when we nullify the mass, we also have a negative energy component to that pair too, because the pair exists right above 0 point. There has to be some sort of negative energy component there too, you know, that you're accessing. So it's not only a nullification of mass, but also you're tapping into negative energy. There's two things going on there. Okay. The nullification of mass is the counter rotation.
Right. Going on in this one, the simple transistor, the three-wire transistor,
right,
when that is put together, and those things are actually mocked up, you've got basically two charges coming in on one side and a charge coming that are opposing and a tap off the bottom. And when it's set up properly, they found it was an amplifier, and they're using geranium or silicone as the base, silicon as the base, but it is the basis of all electronic circuitry. How do you get something out of nothing without tapping into 0 point? And in the small scale, this three-wire transistor is basically doing this. Now, when we look into some of Tesla's work, he's taking the same notion, instead of having, because the transistor wasn't invented until after the 1940s and 1950-ish that we got the expansion of transistors. But what it does is when it fires on one side with a small amount of current, you end up with an increase on the other side. And what we're looking at with the devices you're driving and work that I'm working with is that we're seeing up fields of interaction that are very, very similar to how the transistor actually works in a small electrical system that we have in the on the push side of the electrical. We're taking and saying, we're going to do a little draw on one side of these vortices and pulling out more on the other side. And it's the same principle, it's the same, circuit, it's the same drawing. It works on different, I don't care whether it's the heat exchange pump for water or for air or for counter currents in one exchange and the other, it's that opposition of force, one traveling across the other, that gives you this reaction, this bonus off the other side.
Well,
go ahead.
When I went to school here, IIT, I mean, they taught, you know, transistor theory, where you have electrons and then you have these positive particles that were called holes, you know, this hole theory. And so when you look at what Feynman talked about in Stuckelberg in your article, they were saying, see, there's two things. See, the whole thing gets complex. You almost have to understand, you know, how the electron is constructed, okay, to kind of grasp what's going on with everything. Because the electron has all these different properties. You know, it has this charge. And what Feynman talked about is that, wait a minute, the positron is a time-reversed particle. And he shows that in his Feynman diagrams. The problem is that those electrons can have they can emit positive energy angular momentum. So here you can have a time reverse charged particle like a positron, but it exists in real space because it has positive angular momentum associated with that. If it had negative angular momentum, the phase, if you forced the phase to go into Dirac hyperspace, it wouldn't even be here. It would show up as a hole. But since the since the electron and the positron manifest in our real 3D universe, what defines that is the angular momentum has to have positive energy associated with it, a positive phase, so that it can manifest in real 3D space. So it may have a time reverse charge associated with that, but it exists in 3D space because it has positive angular momentum, a time forward angular momentum associated with it.
Okay. We do realize that when we see these devices that are approaching basically lift drive type of technology, that we do get an angular rotation of the device before it falls off the table or we get some lift. It looks, so far I've seen, is temporary. It hasn't been, you know, sustainable, but the first component is the angle rotation as the device seems to lighten in this experience.
Right. Okay.
So as I said, I'm going along with what you're saying, because as you decrease the mass, then your angular rotation takes over simply because you've stopped the attraction to the planet Earth. It stops its rotation. When you decrease the weight, and then you end up with a less frictional force between the two, and it starts to rotate as it breaks loose from the surface of the planet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you see, in order to do that, you have to change big G, okay? Big G and Newton's equation is what we're engineering. Big G is what we're doing here. I mean, yeah, we're affecting the mass of the system, but we're also there's another dimension. There's always another dimension to this stuff. That's what makes it so complex and a real challenge.
What was interesting about the transistor is that you can get an AC current on one side that's small, run it through the transistor, and it amplifies. The voltage is higher, but the wave itself is inverted. And so using that same logic, when we take a look at big G, is we take big G, run it through the circuitry as part of the components, the drill along, and invert it. And so we go from two positive, you know, a positive and negative attraction that we have for our gravitational, to where we have basically two positives, let's say, of gravitational, big G, in opposition to each other, starting to get away from each other. So
right. Yeah,
that's basically repulsed. What we're looking at is changing spin, inverting the circuitry, and causing an inversion of G, which gives you a repulsion rather than an attraction. And some work that we've been talking about is to get rid of the word magnetic as something that sticks your magnet to the steel, to your magnetic force is an attractive gravitational force that pulls stuff to it. And and basically mirror what you've been saying this morning. And that's what I'm very pleased to hear somebody else working on that same notion of thought. It's expansion and contraction versus the, you know, what is magnetic in the magnet forms that we historically we've been taught.
Yeah, and then what that comes down to again, you know, that I spoke about, vacuum polarization, you know, is how all these things, you know, the electromagnetic ether is one level, but there's also a level below that which manifests charge of the particle. There's something else there, some sort of a soup of something that can manifest charge, and that too can be time reversed. Okay, you can have a positive charge, which is complex, and then a negative charge is an electron, okay, which is manifest in the real 3D universe. So you can also have that, you know, these added dimensions to this of time forward and time reverse. And that's why Feynman kind of looked at the positron as a time reverse particle, and he's partially correct. Okay, it's just that the charge of the positron is time reversed, but it has positive angular momentum, which allows you to manifest that particle in the real 3D universe.
Okay, excellent. We're going to give open this to the rest of the viewers right now. And are there somebody else that want to ask William a question? I'm working out.
Is everyone else blown away?
Oh, yes, terribly, terribly. This is not our first rodeo, but we're just barely crawling towards the edge of the hole.
See, at Auroratek here, we're looking at all these things, you know, not just, you know, energy, but also biotech, too. So we're seeing some really interesting things in the biotech area where we use our technology to accelerate plant growth. Okay, mm-hmm. We see that phenomenon occurring. And also in therapy pads, we put our technology into pads. You can put it on the back of your car seat or the in your office chair, and you feel like an energizing effect from it. And so all that we're doing is lowering the field energy. And the question then, you know, why do plants respond in a positive way, faster plant growth, when you don't raise the energy, you lower it. You lower the field energy. And that's what our technology is all about. You know, for free energy, anti-gravity, we're lowering the field energy, okay, of the surrounding medium. You lower that, and you see all these really cool effects, like accelerated plant growth. It feels energizing to you because you're lowering this, you know, like with pain and fatigue, you know, the two are related. So if you lower the field energy, let's say in your back and you're on a long road trip, you feel less pain, less fatigue, okay? And so that's the effect there. So we're coming out with our pads, with our accelerated plant growth technology. That's kind of like our first introduction. And again, you know, it lowers the field energy. Rather than raise it, you lower it. And so we see all these really interesting effects. That's our biotech division. We also have our energy division, is where we're looking at this Floyd Sweet-like technology, and also our space division, where we look at anti-gravity and warp drive technology. So that's what we're doing.
Excellent. Here. Yeah, we're seeing similar work with different people that are experimenting in the plasma technology, and basically they're working with the expansion portion of the fields, making them larger, and looking at the interaction between them. We're also looking at things of reducing metals into the atomic level and then pulling the fields off of them in the liquid form, basically structuring water and applying them to plants. And
similar
stuff happening. And in my work with my greenhouse and my nursery, we basically did the structured water and we're treating the vegetable plants, and we're getting the same flavor and actually more energy feeling out of them when you eat the fruits and the vegetables from it, from the structured water
exactly
that put onto these plants. And it gives them the flavor as if they were field grown organically, but yet they're inside the greenhouse. They're in a very controlled environment, which usually yields, you know, blah tasting tomatoes and, you know, celery and asparagus or whatever else. Not that great, but we put it in with these fields, the structured waters, or the plasma fields with the expanding field on it,
Right.
The plants taste, the materials taste better when we consume them. So this is very exciting.
Oh, yeah. Yes. So we're looking at huge breakthroughs, you know, in the biotech area. Also accelerated healing type of technologies. Everything that you see on Star Trek, you know, want to manifest. So
yeah, we're seeing that. And with the work that James is doing, something that I'm working on, and certainly what, you know, you've gone way ahead on, we're seeing a convergence from all these different fields are starting to come together and they're saying, now, wait a minute. This model that we've been taught in school isn't quite working as well as we thought it should.
No.
And that we're changing the model.
Right, exactly. And Hodson went as far as to say, you know, that the standard model is just plain wrong, what they have. I mean, the whole science curriculum here just moved off into this wrong direction. What they teach in school is just positive energy systems. Mm-hmm. You know, and,
yeah,
and
as I say, the
was just
the
part out of the equation.
You betcha.
But it's there. It's always been
We've got 15 minutes, and I need to round table it past the people that are here for their once every two weeks chance to say hi. This is what we're doing. John, do you have anything for us today? He's got his mic off.
He's probably just listening.
Okay, no problem. James, let's see who I'm going to do first. You've got John. Vince? Give me a moment. Vince has got his mic off. Shannon?
Hey guys, enjoying the presentation. Thank you.
Anything else for Shannon? Okay, James.
Yeah. I had some more questions for William, but I don't think we're gonna have time to go over it. Tom wanted me to ask, why is the negative spike so large? But I don't know what context he's asking that in because he's not here right now. I don't know, William, you want
to... What we're finding when we start a small negative draw, we're getting the larger negative spike out of it. And we've been scratching our heads with our team, and what William's talking about is starting to make more sense. So go ahead, William. The negative spike, William? Why is this a lot?
I don't know. Can you hear us? I mean, I hear you, Franz. I don't know what's going on. I had Tom also submitted a video and he wanted me to play it. It's 9 minutes. It's about the Bob Boyce coil. Do you want me to play that? And it's
let's have that in the notes at the bottom. And have it as a link. We can do that. That's a problem because we are running out of time.
All right. Okay. So everyone checked it out. I guess we'll have to. We could always try. We could always play it next week, I suppose. Just check.
Is Bob Boyce here?
I wish.
No. You know, I met him at the Extraordinary Tech Conference last year. He's an interesting fellow.
Yeah, Tom is working with the Bob Boyce coils. He's making some breakthroughs. I think he's having some problems with it. It's just the power is overloading it. It's so strong that he can't figure out a way to make it safely without burning everything up. I guess there's so much power in the vacuum. But go ahead, Frank.
We're looking at basically putting resistors in the way of the direction to ground, to earth ground, to basically stop the runaway circuit. The Joule ring circuits and some of these others that they have a tendency, if you don't have a constant power supply, a regulated power supply, that they basically would go into thermal decay. They just burn themselves up, especially if the person is using matter state wires instead of nano coat, which is puts you into superconductivity. So there's the premise when it starts out, you end up with too much. It has a tendency to go to thermal runaway, and as the wires get hotter, they conduct more, and pretty soon they just burn up. So resistance in that last step before it goes to earth ground is probably going to be something we have to take a look at.
Yeah, I just have a comment. You know, when you work with negative energy, you have to keep in mind that you're working with this, it's a negative work function. So the electrons, they're still moving around the circuit, but they're there. You can apply electric force to them, positive electric force, and those electrons that have negative energy associated with them, and you know, this is what Floyd Sweet was working with, is that on your input side, it looks like you have no power being delivered to your device, you know, because you have this negative work function you have. So those electrons that have curled right into hyperspace, they're still there moving in the circuit, but the real field just basically vanishes, okay? So it looks like you have nothing going in, but yet your transformers will still be powering a big load with them. You still can get real power from that.
Anything else, James?
No, well, I guess just one other mention. I don't know if William, Tom has been experimenting mixing GONs into epoxy, and he's having trouble actually getting the epoxy to set. And then he says the energy peaks. I don't know if either you two, Franz or William, would like to comment about that, what you think might be going on there. And he's going to just stop using GONs altogether. I don't know if William.
Epoxy?
GONs and epoxy.
This is the monoatomic stuff that comes basically through electrolysis. You end up with a sediment at the bottom in your aqueous solutions that is basically your anode, your cathode being reduced to atomic level. We're finding that we use it to basically flavor off of the coils and stuff, so that when you have the expansion of the field through what they call GANs, which is gas at nanometer, which is just this monoatomic particles, that it flavors the production of the expanding field because it's affected by it. It's very similar to your fluorescent tubes. When you put a charge through it, you end up with a light that's a nice cool white or a room temperature light because of coating that the plasma transfers to it, excites it, and gives you light. In the coils that they're using, they're putting paste over the top of, or the liquid portion over the top of the coils, and this flavors the electromagnetic field that's generated from it. That explains it. It's very rudimentary.
You're working with HHO?
I think it's a Bob Boyce coil with epoxy and GONs. And Tom isn't having luck with that combination.
I forgot. What we end up with is most of your GANs are water-based, so to get to stay in the epoxy, because they're usually a petroleum product, they'll have to go to powder form of the GANs and then mix it in the matte state, and it starts to look more like granite rock information and separating the different particles of bands, and depending on which one you're using, whether it's the copper oxide or what they call CH3, which is a ferric oxide component, then you're going to have this concretion that you're forming that'll be spaced apart and held. So you might have to look at going to dry, because you may end up with actually plasmatic field interaction with the two epoxy trying to come together in another chemical reaction with this other field that you're putting in with your hands. So that's my
thought. I use JB Weld.
Yeah, Tom's
which form of the
magnets.
Yeah, I'll let them know. Okay, thank you, William and Frog. Okay. Appreciate it.
Okay.
So does anyone have anything else to share? And if not, Fraz, do you know who's going to be our speaker next week or 2 weeks from now?
I have no idea. I know we have a backlog of folks that have been meeting with their devices. Hopefully Stefan will make it in. And it'd be nice to hear your team. Somebody else? Go ahead.
Oh, I just clicked on the YouTube link there.
Oh, okay. No problem. So I know James has been working with the other batch of researchers.
I'm working with
alternate wire stuff.
Yeah, Tom and I were trying to come up with something, and he's got some metaphysical products too, like a pyramid with this type of Orgo matrix. So it's not just free energy, but chi. I guess chi is free energy. Not really. Well, I guess it could power your car, I suppose. There's ways of doing it. So be curious to see where that goes. And thank you, William. Thank you, listeners. Shall we conclude this meeting?
Okay. We're available every other week at this time and place, this channel. And William, you're always welcome to come back.
Okay.
We really appreciate you. Or if you've got somebody else that's in your group of friends that would like to talk on a subject, we'd be more than happy to listen to them too. But we really appreciate your talk today. It gave us a lot to think about in looking basically over the horizon a little bit from where we are right now. We're coming up on the edge of that hill, and you're looking over the top at the other side. So talking with you on that one, it's we kind of all of us work to educate the others, and gives us a little more insight of what's going on in the world we see in 3D. So thank you very much. Hope to see you again.
It's my pleasure. Yeah, thanks for the invitation.
Thanks, everyone. Goodbye.
Thank you.